This is Touching Bases at Spring Training with WREX-TV Sports Director Jock Florentine. Brought to you by Jeffries AMC Jeep, one of the largest dealers in Northern Illinois. And by Barnaby's, the family inn.
Every year, thousands of Northerners head south for one of sport's greatest events, spring training. The Chicago Cubs draw as well as anyone at their home away from home in Mesa, Arizona, and that's where we begin the spring training special. The Cubs stirred a lot of interest in the offseason with an eight-player deal with Philadelphia. Despite losing slick fielding second baseman Manny Trio, the Cubs came out ahead. Chicago gets three starters, including 34-year-old veteran Ted Sizemore, who will replace Trio at second base.
With no injuries, I'll hit anywhere from between 280 and 300, and I'd like to lead the league again in double plays. I've done it about three times, and just little things like that. I don't try to say I'm going to hit 330 or something like that. I have to stay within my capabilities because I usually am batting behind a base stealer. You know, I'll be doing it here against with De Jesus. I did it in St. Louis with Brock and in L.A. with Will. So I'm used to batting second, and I think I can help Yvonne become a much better ball player.
What type of things can you do off the field itself to help the Cubs become a winner?
Well, just I talk baseball a lot, and I don't know if the Cubs do, you know, when they're on the road. You know, if you're out at a bar or out having dinner or whatever you may be doing, having a good time, I think you got to talk baseball and talk winning. And I'm a very positive person. I don't believe in losing, and maybe I can bring some of that attitude over here if that's what it takes. That's what I'll be doing.
You've been with the Phillies for a couple of years. What did you think your chances are now being a Cub of beating Philadelphia?
Well, our chances are very good. The Phillies, you know, have made some big moves, and they've got Pete Rose, and, you know, Pete's going to get some hits for him leading off. But in the other hand, they've given up some speed in that leadoff position with Bake not leading off.
What does Jerry Martin think he's going to do playing a full season in center field?
Well, I'm from the Carolinas, and a guy made a statement the other day that every guy he's seen to come out of the Carolinas playing ball has been aggressive, so I consider myself aggressive. I go up there, and one thing in mind to the plate is to swing the bat, and I go hard out in the outfield after everything, too, so I like to play aggressive.
And if I can contribute in some way between April 5th till October 1st, then, that's really all I'm looking for. I can't predict anything, but I think I can help the ball club.
What do you say to those that say, well, the Cubs got a third-string catcher in Barry Foote?
Well, anybody that says that doesn't know anything about baseball. So, you know, let them take their $10,000, $12,000 a year home with them and tell them, ask them to check it out and see if that's what I'm making as a third-string catcher. Now, there's no argument there. What can I argue about? The guy says that, just doesn't understand baseball, doesn't know anything about it. So there's really no argument. It'd be like really nothing I can argue about because I can just show them statistics and tell them to, you know, base it on that.
At this time in your career, what things do you think you have to improve on individually?
I just got to get a chance to play and find out what I need to work on then. I sat around for 2 years because of different things that went on, not really that were pertaining to baseball so much as abilities, as much as just things that worked out differently than they should have under the circumstances.
With all that taken into consideration, I think you'd be happy to get a shot here with the Cubs.
Oh, yeah. I wanted to play every day, and I think this is a great opportunity to.
Shortstop Yvonne De Jesus, now nearing all-star caliber, anchors the infield. De Jesus batted .278 with 41 stolen bases in 78. The Cubs infield will get a big boost this season. Third baseman Steve Ontiveros and first baseman Bill Buckner appear to be healthy after missing action last season with injuries. Ontiveros' batting average dropped 50 points from his 77 season. Still, the Cubs pace the league in team batting average. The big sore spot, though, the club finished next to last in home runs. Bobby Mercer, making $320,000 a year, hit only nine and needs to come to life or lose his right field spot to Scott Thompson. Thompson has been impressive in the field and at the plate. Dave Kingman topped the Cubs with 28 home runs despite missing a month with a leg injury. But King Kong was the only Cub to break double figures in the long ball department. With or without power, pitching will make or break the 79 Cubs. Rick Reuschel will head a starting rotation, which includes Lynn McLaughlin and Ken Holtzman. That trio managed just 19 wins in 78. Reuschel, a 20-game winner in 77, is hoping to avoid elbow troubles that have nagged him the past 2 years.
Well, I threw about the right number of innings, but I did it in almost a month less. I missed almost a month when I was pitching. I I threw more innings per game than I usually did, and my arm was still tired at the end of the year. But it was a bad month. I couldn't throw, couldn't do anything to help us out, and we were having trouble. So I hope I can stay away from that this year.
Is that something that might worry you this season?
No, I'm not going to worry about it. If it happens, it happens. And nothing I can do about it before, you know, just got to wait. And if it pops up, then we'll have to try to get it taken care of.
Ken Holtzman could be part of the answer. But remember, he has done little more than pick up splinters the past two seasons with the Yankees before going to the Cubs late last season.
Physically, my arm is as sound as it ever was. It's just now a matter of more or less relearning and regaining some confidence and getting my control back, which is, you know, really deserted me, obviously, at the end of 2 years of inactivity. But I think it'll take me probably about four or five times out before I get a more or less an idea of what I'm doing with each pitch, and hopefully by the opening day of the season, I'll be ready.
Well, do you have any doubts about your pitching ability after what's gone by the last couple of years?
Well, mentally maybe, in that, you know, it's when you're a starting pitcher for 11 or 12 years and all of a sudden you're more or less, you just sit down day after day for two full years is what it amounts to. There's some doubt, sure. I mean, I'm confident that with given enough time that I can get back to once where I once was, because physically I've kept myself in shape. But nevertheless, there's still that element of doubt, and I think it's getting over that mental obstacle that'll be the biggest thing here.
Bruce Sutter anchors the bullpen, but without improvement from the likes of McLaughlin, Mike Grucco, and Dennis Lamp, the Cubs will find it hard to improve on last year's third place finish, and perhaps find it hard to hold Montreal to fourth. The Expos have better pitching than the Cubs, with starters Steve Rogers and Ross Grimsley, plus power and outfielders Ellis Valentine and Andre Dawson, each hit 25 home runs in 78. The Expos have a solid infield with the likes of Dave Cash, Chris Spire, and Tony Perez. But it's the Pittsburgh Pirates who are the real threat to end Philadelphia's three-year reign in the East. The Pirates finished just one game back last year. A healthy Willie Stargell could make the difference, but the Bucks' top player is Dave Parker. Parker won the National League Most Valuable Player Award by hitting .334 with 30 home runs and 117 RBIs. And not so surprisingly, has a new contract worth $1 million a year. The Phils also have their millionaire, Pete Rose, who came over from Cincinnati.
Get a lot of hitting over here, a lot of ground balls. I think the difference in camps, I've only been to two since now in Philadelphia. I think the Phillies spend a lot more time on fundamentals.
Is that right?
We talked about fundamentals a lot at Cincinnati and did a little bit, but here we do a half hour of covering first, covering second, covering third, and hitting the cutoffs every day. And, you know, when you're in a good division like we are in the Eastern Division of the National League, there's a lot of one-run ball games, and the team who wins the most one-run ball games, the team's going to win the division.
Yeah.
Another new face in the Phils lineup this year is second baseman Manny Treo. Treo came to the Phils from the Cubs in an eight-player deal, and he'll make them that much tougher to beat in 79. The San Francisco Giants were the most improved team in the National League last year by winning 89 games, 12 better than 77. Vida Blue was an important reason. Coming over from Oakland, he won 18 games and finished third in the Cy Young voting.
I didn't worry about the mind games then. It was just there with the other team that I was working for. And it's unfortunate that that had to happen, because I really feel as though it hampered my performance somewhat. It, you know, it was doing something to me mentally. And I just would like to think of what my performances could have been like if, you know, all this, that turmoil wasn't there. So it's all behind me. We'll turn the page and we'll keep looking forward, you know.
You're a crafty veteran now. Are you a better pitcher than you were when you came up?
I don't think I'm no better. I think I've learned how to pitch. And I think that the experience is one of the biggest things anyone can have going for them. You know, if you know how to do something. I used to get pre-game butterflies, but now I just approach as though it's another game, and that's the way I try to see it, and just do my best each and every time I'm on the field.
Rounding out the Giants pitching rotation is 17-game winner Bob Nepper, All-Star John the Count Montefusco, and fireballing righty Ed Halicki. Pitching alone will keep the Giants in contention, but they have more. Outfielder Billy North signed on at the start of the spring as a free agent. He played with LA last year and will assume the leadoff spot with his ability to steal bases.
I think Billy ranks in the top two or three as far as leadoff men in the big leagues today. And I think we have to try to take full advantage of it, simply because we haven't been with what we call an authentic leadoff hitter in the 3 years I've been here. Bill Madlock did a super job for us leading off last year, but Billy is a consistently 300 hitter, and we like to move him either second or third in our lineup so he'll have the capabilities of driving in some runs for us.
Batting behind North is former Cub Bill Madlock, who has four straight 300 seasons. Third baseman Darrell Evans, who slugged 20 home runs last year. All-star outfielder Jack Clark, who batted 306 with 25 home runs. And first baseman Mike Ivey, who hit over 300 last season while sharing first base with Willie McCovey. This year, Ivey has put old number 44 on the bench, but McCovey will see plenty of duty. The National League champion Dodgers not only lost Billy North in the free agent draft, but 17-game winner Tommy John. Still, manager Tommy Lasorda is predicting a third straight division title.
I'll tell you this much, when we lost Tommy John and Lee Lacy, Billy North, and Jerry Grody, everybody said, hey, boy, they're going to really feel the effects of that. But I commend Al Campanis and Peter O'Malley. They went out and signed ball players in the persons of Andy Messersmith, Von Joshua, Gary Thomason, Darryl Thomas, and Pete Broberg. And I'll tell you right now, I think our ball club right now, bench-wise, is better. And if Andy Messersmith can continue to pitch the way he has, this could be the greatest steal since the Brinks robbery. I don't know how much they got in that, but we'll get a ton of this one.
Despite the loss of John, the Dodgers' pitching staff is among the best in baseball. Former Cub Bert Hooten won 19 games and finished second in the Cy Young balloting. At first base, there's Steve Garvey, who always seems to shed his nice guy image at the plate. Last year, all he did was bat 316 with 21 home runs and 113 RBIs. The Cincinnati Reds will make it a three-team race even without Pete Rose. His successor at third base, Ray Knight, will make things easier for the rest of the infield, but will not match Rose at the plate.
I know people start saying, well, you're going to replace Pete Rose, you're going to do this and do that. And there's definitely pressure, but it's all in the matter of how individual copes with it. And I'm just trying to get out here and work as hard as I possibly can and get all the negative thoughts out of my mind and just go from there.
Knight has been slowed this spring by injury, and that has not helped. The Reds' lineup is still loaded with power, but the Reds need more improvement from their pitchers, especially Tom Seaver. The world champion Yankees are the odds maker's choice in the American League East, but look out for Milwaukee. The Brewers' 93 wins in 78 was 26 better than in 77. All-star outfielder Larry Heisel keyed the Brewers' rise to contention by paying some big dividends on his $3.5 million contract. Heisel hit 34 home runs and 115 RBIs as Milwaukee led the majors in hitting. Joining Heisel in the outfield are three other big swingers: Gorman Thomas, who clubbed 32 homers, rifle-armed right fielder Sixto Lescano, who hit for a .292 average, and 300 hitter Ben Ogilvy. The infield is equally deep with 23-year-old All-Star Robin Yount at shortstop and 22-year-old Paul Molitor, the Rookie of the Year, at second.
Right, you know, the Sporting News Rookie of the Year, which is a vote of the players, I received that award, and it was very satisfactory just to know that the players around the league gain their respect a little bit. I think that was one of my objectives of last season, was to feel like I was accepted here in the major leagues, and I feel that award kind of symbolizes that.
Okay, what do you look for individually this year? What do you want to improve on?
Well, number one, being a leadoff man, I definitely have to work on my strike zone. You know, 520 at-bats last year and only 19 walks, so I have to learn a few more ways to steal first base, so to speak, and I think improving my strike zone will be a big step in getting that goal.
Well, I guess that's all you have to learn, how to steal, because you know how to steal second, third, and maybe home already, right?
Well, you know, I love to get on those bases. I feel steal a base here or there, and I think, you know, it's the key to winning those close ball games. And when you have RBI men like Heisel and Cooper and Money and those people behind you, if you know you're on second base, you got a heck of a chance to score.
The addition of 17-game winner Jim Slayton through the free agent draft makes the team's starting rotation five men strong, and that makes Milwaukee the best seven-inning club in baseball. But Milwaukee is still short the stopper in the bullpen.
All right, well, what we've done, so we only had one left-hander last year. We moved Wilkerstein down, so we have two left-handers in the bullpen. And, of course, we have Cleveland and Castro. Now, those four men I just mentioned are all short men. In other words, I could put them in the sixth inning if they have a big rally going and maybe try to get out of that inning and always have one man behind them for the later innings. So I feel our pitching staff has improved. There's no doubt about it. But when you say, well, if it's improved, you should win a lot more games. Well, we won 93 last year. And, of course, that's enough to win a pennant a lot of times. But I think it's going to take 100 games this year, really.
Well, you look at your lineup, you have actually four outfielders and five infielders, and it's too bad there isn't an 11-man team because you'd have the best in the business.
Right, we have good depth to our ball club. That was the secret last year. And I think offensive-wise, we got the best hitting team in baseball. I really do. Defensive-wise, we're in about in the middle, but I think we're going to improve because we have a lot of young boys on this club, and we have a great mixture of veterans and young boys.
Do you feel like Milwaukee can beat the Yankees this year?
I think that way. I think we all feel that way. It's just a matter of us, you know, doing it, you know, at one time, everybody pulling together and doing it as a team.
The return of catcher Ray Fossey, who sat out last season with a knee injury, gives Milwaukee three veteran catchers. His bat could add even more punch to the lineup. The world champion Yankees will not only have to battle Milwaukee and its other rivals in the East, but also complacency that comes along with two straight world titles and three straight division crowns.
The additions are, that we had, Tommy John and Louis T, out there used to winning. This club thinks they can win every ball game. When they go to the park, they expect to win, and they're very disappointed when they don't. People hear a lot of things off the field about them, but when they cross the white line, they're a well-knit team group, a team effort.
Cy Young winner Ron Guidry will have a tough act to follow. In 78, his 25-3 record was only surpassed by a brilliant 1.74 ERA.
Well, I'm not going to try to go out there this year and try to match it because it's that'd be a big job. I think I pitched well enough last year, you know, because we really needed all the help that we could get, and maybe I went above my head, and maybe I set a plateau that I'll never be able to reach again. But I had a good year when I think the club needed it most, and Tommy John and Tiant this year, I think it's going to take a little bit of pressure from the pitching staff that we have. So they're going to win a few games, and I'm going to win what I'm hoping is a share of my games. And as long as I give it 110%, I'm satisfied.
In the American League West, the California Angels are promising that this is their year. The club has been disappointing in each of the last three seasons when its high-priced talent has failed to bring home a division title. But this year's newly acquired star, Rod Carew, could make the difference.
Well, you know, I don't want to be counted on as the only person. You know, it's got to take all 25 guys. But I think that I can help them win some ball games. And I know that they needed a left-handed hitting first baseman. They needed a left-handed hitter, a guy that could play every day. And I'm just glad that I could fill the bill. I'm just glad that they traded for me.
The Angels shared second with Texas, five games behind Kansas City in 78. And pitcher Nolan Ryan, coming off a subpar 10-13 record, shoulders part of the blame for not finishing first.
Well, I definitely have to have a better year than I had last year. The type of year I had might have made the difference whether we could have won our division or not. We were five games behind Kansas City, and I had a poor year due to injuries.
The Royals are looking for a fourth straight division title, and once again, the team remains pretty much the same as the year before.
Rod Carew could help any team. He could help the Cebu Lions from Japan. I think he could make them a contender, but you're dealing with the Kansas City Royals. We've won it three straight years. We haven't been picked to win it three straight years. I don't think any year we were picked or a favorite to win our division, but yet we keep on going out there with no names, it seems like, and always bringing a guy up from the minor league system rather than buying a free agent for millions of dollars. And it's worked out good for us. I see no reason why it can't work out one more year.
The White Sox feature the league's littlest big man. That's 5'3" and shortstop Harry Chappas.
I don't want to be considered as a gimmick. I don't want to be up there for that reason, you know. If I win the job, I want to play shortstop up in Chicago. If not, then I'll go to AAA.
Chappas might be a draw at the gate, but player-manager Don Kessinger isn't ready to predict a championship.
Well, I don't know how quickly we can. We can. I just don't know how quickly we can. You know, there's some great ball clubs in this division, Kansas City, Texas, California, there, to name three, that are excellent ball clubs. Minnesota's not a bad ball club, and so just how quickly we can get there remains to be seen. We think we're a lot better ball club than we were a year ago, and we have some fine young pitchers, and how far we go depends a great deal on how they do.
The expansion Mariners are entering their third season, and they probably will improve some on their 56-104 record of 78. One of the bright young stars on the Mariners roster is second baseman Julio Cruz, who stole 59 bases as a rookie, despite hitting .235.
I think I really got tired the last couple of months. The last 3 months of the season, I wanted to steal so many bases that
I was putting too much pressure up on the plate. Like, I wanted to get on first base without even going to the plate. I just wanted to, you know, get on the field and say, hey, I'm on first, and not even go up there and take my cuts. And this time around in spring training, I'm really working hard on bunting, and it's making me stay back, and I'm watching the ball and seeing everything much clearer this way. And with the Lord providing and all, I will get my average up.
Thing you got to do is learn how to steal first, right?
Right. I can't get a good jump to steal first base. That's kind of hard, you know? No. There's nobody in the world who can do that.
One of the main men in the Cubs pennant hopes this year is relief pitcher Bruce Sutter. When he trots onto the field, it's for one reason, to snuff out the other team's rally. Sutter is no ordinary relief pitcher. In 2 years, he has notched 58 saves with 15 wins, and that's why he's regarded as one of baseball's best firemen.
Well, I'm kind of surprised about how well I have done, but, you know, when you're in a game and it's a competitive game, I'm a competitor, I always strive to be the best at what I'm doing, and, you know, I'm not perfect, but I'm still trying to be. I like being a relief pitcher. I like when I'm in there and the game's on the line and there's as much pressure on the hitter as there is a pitcher. I feel if I can get that hitter a little bit nervous, maybe swinging a bad pitches, I feel like I have the advantage over him.
Do you ever think maybe you'd like to be a starting pitcher?
No, because basically I'm a one-pitch pitcher. I might be all right for the first time around the order, but then, you know, fourth, fifth, and sixth innings, I might be struggling.
Sutter's out pitch is the split-fingered fastball. Some batters complain that when it approaches the plate, it looks like it drops off a table. And perhaps that's why he averages more than a strikeout an inning.
Well, it took me 3 years to where, you know, I could get the ball to break, but I had trouble controlling it. And it doesn't matter what pitch you throw. If you can't get it over some of the time when you want to, it's no good to you.
But you certainly have confidence in that pitch.
Oh, yeah. Well, I owe everything I have to that pitch. Fred Martin taught me the pitch, and, you know, I just kept working at it. I had to have something if I wanted to make it to the big leagues.
Does it give you a good feeling to know you can go up there and get anybody out?
Well, on some days I can get anybody out, and some days anybody can hit me.
Last season, Sutter seemed to tire in the long months of August and September. But despite working in 62 games in 77 and 64 more last year, he denies claims that his arm is wearing out.
That's an unusual pitch, but it really no wear tearing on my arm. I throw it the same way as I throw a fastball. It's not like I'm throwing sliders or curveballs where I'm twisting my elbow. It's a pretty easy pitch on my arm. So far, I haven't had any pain in my arm, and I feel like I'm throwing pretty good right now.
Have you and the coaches maybe mapped out a game plan for this year on how many innings they want to throw you before maybe the pennant race in August or September actually gets underway?
See, you can't, as a relief pitcher, you can't ever get the ideal situation where you pitch three or four times a week and only a couple innings at a time. I pitch according to how the team's going. If we're winning a lot of games, then, you know, consequently, I'm going to be pitching a lot of games. But if we hit a bad spell where we're not winning many games, I won't be pitching. So it's hard to sit down before a season and just say how many games I am going to throw in.
If the 26-year-old Sutter has a good year in 79, you can bet the Cubs will, too. That's how things shape up at spring training this year. What you have seen will help determine who will win and who will lose in 79. From the Valley of the Sun in Arizona, this is Jock Florentine for Touching Bases at Spring Training.
Touching Bases at Spring Training with Jock Florentine was brought to you by Barnaby's, the Family Inn, and by Jeffrey's AMC Jeep, one of the largest dealers in Northern Illinois. This has been a WREX-TV videotape presentation.